garbage in is garbage out. It's one of those cliches that you've probably heard so often by now that you've grown to hate it, but as with many cliches, it holds true. And especially so in the world of data, because the quality of your data directly influences your insights, your models, and the decisions that you take. And that is why in today's video, we're going to explore why you, and me of course, should care about data testing and a tool that I often use for that called Great Expectations. And the timing couldn't have been better because they just released their version 1. So, interested in the topic? Yeah, let's dive into the content. When working with data, it's easy to assume that it's clean, consistent, and ready to use. But in reality, that's often not the case. I've experienced that many times, even when sourcing data from paid providers. So it's really like this XKCD post, assumptions are a tricky thing. This is even more critical for machine learning systems. Unlike traditional software, machine learning depends not just on code, but also on data and models, each of which needs rigorous testing, as you can see from this figure. The data defines the model's ability to learn and infer, so it's not just a supporting element, it's the foundation. So with that in mind, there are a lot of things that we need to monitor and test, but today I would really like to focus on the foundation. Does the data that we receive conform to our expectations? And in order to do just that, we'll be using Great Expectations. Great Expectations, or GX for short, is an open source tool designed to help data engineers validate, document, and profile their data. You first define which data you want to validate, you then formulate your test as expectations, and then define subsequent actions to take upon the completion of these validations. Now, GX takes care of the generation and storage of artifacts throughout this process, and also comes with a built-in validation result website that they call DataDocs. Now, I hear you thinking, Jorik, this sounds amazing, and yes, I have to admit, it does, but obviously, GX is not perfect, and that's something that we'll explore in this and also in other videos, but at the very least, it makes the data testing process systematic and scalable. And on top of that, they have a pretty active community of developers who listen to feedback and really try to implement your suggestions as soon as possible, if they make sense, of course. Heck, even I was able to make a contribution a couple of weeks ago. So with that bit of theory out of the way, let's dive into some coding. So for this first exploration of Great Expectations, I've divided the workflow into two steps, mainly setup and run. And this is also something that you'll see in my VS Code, where I have defined a script called GX setup and a script called GX run. And this is also generally how you would go about using GX, where you first set up your project, make sure your expectation suite and other artifacts and objects are configured, to then at runtime make use of those and be able to easily validate new incoming data. So, with that being said, what you see in script is that I first import Great Expectation in pandas because I'll be loading data into memory and validating it from there. And then I proceed to set a series of artifact names. But let's not focus on these artifact names and related artifacts too much for now. We'll run into them as we progress through the bits of this script. So what I'll do is I'll first load up this bit of the script, which makes the necessary imports, sets a bunch of constants, and then loads a data set. And this data set is on taxi trips, which I downloaded for free on the internet, and I've downloaded two. So first you have the one from November 21, and this one we'll use for the configuration and the setup bit that we're looking at right now. And then the second one we'll use to validate data at runtime. So with that being said, let's return to the setup script, and there I'll call the first method from the Great Expectations package, getContext with mode file. And what this does is it initializes a project setup for Great Expectations locally on my machine, so on a local file storage, and that's also what you see here in the Explorer. It created a GX folder with directories for artifacts and a Great Expectations YAML file that contains configurations for my project setup. For now, let's not dive too deep into that bit, but focus on the main workflow of Great Expectations. So, after creating our data context and the related file backend, what we then first want to do is define a data source that we want to use for validation. And the thing here is that Great Expectations comes with a lot of options to define data sources, how you want to connect to them, how you want to load data, how you want to create batches. But for me, that feels a bit like a scope creep. So the main thing I want to use is in-memory data sources, because that gives me the freedom to define how I want to load my data. And then I just pass the data as an in-memory frame at runtime. So that's also what happens here. I'm creating a data source, a data asset, and a batch definition, saying that I'm using a pandas data source, a data frame asset, and that the batches that I create will always be entire data frames. So when I run this snippet of code, what we'll see is that if I go back to the create expectations YAML file, that it has now added a data source with an asset and a batch definition. So with that out of the way, I'll move back to the main script and I will create an expectation suite. And basically what an expectation suite is, it's just a collection of expectations that you can run over your data set. So given that I've now created a new suite, the next step is to populate it. And this is where you first start to define the tests that you want to run over your data. So you can run tests over your data at differing levels of granularity. As you can see here, the first one is on the level of the table itself. And with this expectation, I simply want to validate that it contains all the columns that I am expecting. So that's what I do here. I retrieve all the columns that I have in my example data set, and I pass that into the expectation and then store it in this suite. And that's what you can then see here. Moving on from table level expectations, you can also have column level expectations. And these really zoom into the specific column where you can test things like a data type, the value set that is in there, distributions, and many more things. The great expectations really comes with a lot of packed in expectations by default. So what I've done here is I've picked a few columns and written expectations for those. So for the first one, I've picked the vendor ID column and created a set expectation. So if we take a look at the example data, we're looking for the vendor ID column. We're testing that the series that you see here only contains values from the set 1 and 2. So let me run that bit and add it to my suite. Then moving on, I also want to test that all of my columns do not have missing values. So what I'll do is I'll reuse the list of columns that I configured before and then just run a loop saying that for each of these columns, I expect the values to not be null. Then I picked two columns that contain specific timestamps, and I wrote, ChatGPT helped me write a nice regex pattern to actually test if these timestamps adhere to the format that I'm expecting. So what I'm doing here is I'm saying, hey, for these two columns and this specific date pattern, I want you to test if the values match that regular expression. So running that part. And then as a last bit, I looked up a few columns that I expect to never be zero: passenger count, trip distance, and trip amount. And there I'm basically doing the same thing. I'm writing a loop in which I'm calling the expect column values to be between, where I'm saying this is the column and the minimum value is zero. So by doing that, I'm bounding the minimum value to zero. It can never be lower than that, but I'm not binding the max value. So basically the max value is unlimited. So with that being said, I'll also add this to my expectation suite, and that completes the suite for now. So now that I've populated my expectation suite, I want to call it over the test data set to see what the results are of these validations. And this is where GX gets a bit convoluted, because in order to do that, I need to use a batch definition to then validate my data. And I think this mainly has to do with all the loading and batching functionalities that GX comes with. And I don't really use that because I just always pass an entire data frame. But in any case, in order to make this thing work, is I have to create batch parameters in which I define that I'm using this in-memory data set as my data frame. I then create a batch by calling the getBatch method of the batch definition and passing these parameters. And then I can call the expectation suite over that batch by calling the validate method, which I do here. So that ran, and then it shows that it has calculated all the validations, and I can also print out the validation results, which is a JSON object, which GX will also automatically store for me. And here I can see that it was a success, meaning that each of the expectations that I defined led to a positive validation based on this test data set. All right, so that's great. We've created an expectation suite, we've populated it with expectations, we ran it over our test data set, and it came out with the results that we were expecting. So now we want to move on with the setup bit and make sure that we can also do this at runtime. And this is where we really have to pave our way through a lot of the GX jargon to get that to work. Because the first thing that we need to do is create an artifact in which we combine the batch with the expectation suite, and that is what they call a validation definition. So I do that first, and then in the next step we need to create a checkpoint. And what the checkpoint does is it bundles up a validation definition, such as one that we just created, one or multiple, and also connects follow-up actions to that. So there what you can do is you can run one or more validations over your data, and then based on the outcome of those validations, do something. So what I'm doing here is I'm passing it an action to update the Datadog's website, and what that looks like and what functionalities that has, we'll get to that in a bit. And then I bundle that together with the validation definition into an object and store it. And what's good to know is that updating of the data docs is just one of the built-in actions. One of the other actions, for example, is sending a Slack message upon completion of your run. And I reckon there are many other actions that you can use. So I'm not sure if you can still follow, but we've had quite a lot of objects to get here, going from a batch definition to a validation definition to a checkpoint. So that's really also one of my main criticisms for GX. It has a lot of jargon, a lot of objects, a lot of things to really wrap your head around in order to understand how it works and what to do. But when you get there, it really becomes quite easy, because given that we've now created this checkpoint object, which bundles everything together, what we can do is we can use that to call this entire bunch of things over new incoming data. I'll get to that in a bit, but first, just to complete this setup run, I'm going to call it again over the test data set by creating a file identifier, a run ID, and then calling the checkpoint. Now we can see that it has successfully run the checkpoint over the data, meaning that the data has again been validated with the expectations that we defined in the suite. But as I mentioned before, I've also connected an action to this checkpoint to automatically update and generate the data docs. So with that as a given, let's take a look. So for this setup, I have made the local file system the artifact store. So I go to the uncommitted directory, then the Datadog's directory, the local site, and this is where it has generated the website. And that website looks like this. So here you can see that there are two sections of this website, validation results and expectation suites. And in the expectation suites bit, we can zoom into the suite that we just defined, and we can find all the expectations that we have defined, but well, we just did so no need to check that out. Hopefully you still remember the things that we put in there. And for the validation results here, you can see that there was one validation run on the yellow trip data, which was our test data set that we used for the configuration bit. So when I click on that, then here you can see the results of the run. And well, the top level statistics part already tells me that there were 26 expectations and all of them were successful. So no need to really browse through all of this, because I'm not going to find any expectations that failed. But if that would be the case, I can also use the filters that show here to really zoom in on the failed validations, because those are the ones that would be of primary interest. And with that, we've just concluded the setup part of GX. And that leads me to the next step, which is run. And this, I feel, is the bit where GX really shines, because after you've properly set up GX and you've created the artifacts to run your validations, then using it at runtime is super easy. And that's what we'll see when I open up this GX run script, because the only things that I need to do is make my imports, define a checkpoint that I want to use, then load my data, and obviously also initialize grid expectations, so I have that configuration file in memory. But with that out of the way, the only thing that I need to do is take that data frame, pass it to my checkpoint object, and then run it. So that's what I'll do here. I'll run that bit of code, wait up for my second Jupyter environment to start up, and then the code will do its magic. And there you have it. New data set, same expectation suite, and new results. So when I switch back to the website and then browse to home, what we'll see is that we've now an additional validation result on the new set of data. And then again, I can open it up and take a look and see if there's anything failed. And well, for the purposes of this tutorial, I chose two data sets that do not contain any errors. So, well, happy day. All our data is correct. And that's where I would like to stop for today, so that in future videos, I'll take more time to further dive into GX, and specifically also the way in which I use GX and build functions and classes on top of it to improve its workflow, to then also continue to deploy it in the cloud so that you really create a validation microservice that you can call at any time when new data comes in. And now I'm curious to hear from you. How do you validate your data? What packages do you use, and what does your workflow look like? Let me know in the comments below, and who knows, maybe it'll be the inspiration for one of my next videos. If you like this kind of content, then don't forget to like and subscribe. Thanks a lot for watching, and hopefully see you next time.